Standby.
You are listening to Musician Today, weekly podcast with Vera Bomenko. Tune in for your insight into a professional musician's life and awesome new music.
Yes. Ani Schnarch. Ist dann die Behandlung. I'm good. How are you? Funnily enough, that was a thing that was always there since I started playing. So I cannot really point out a certain moment where, like, okay, I'm just going to do other kinds of music now. I've been growing up with it since I started playing. For me, it was just part of violin or part of music. Yeah, so there was never just classical music there. There was all sorts of music. I think I was at the age of 11 or 12. It was around then. I wrote my first original piece. It was a trio, violin, cello, and piano. And I performed it with a really dear friend of mine and my sister. We went on the national convention of young composers and we played it there. We do stuff together. We used to when I was living back home because she's a cellist. So sometimes we play things together. We actually recorded recently a very famous song of Dire Straits, Romeo and Juliet. We made our own arrangement of that for violin and cello. With pleasure. Again, almost same story. I got exposed to electric violins around the age of 6 or 7, if I'm not wrong. I started playing at the age of 6. It was the Michael Flatley's Lord of the Dance show that got me hooked up, not just the instruments, but the music as well, Irish music. I just got hooked as a kid. I was sitting like that and watching it. And back then I told myself, okay, one day I'm going to have an electric violin and I'm going to play that kind of music as well. At the very early stages of my starting to learn the violin, I already said that to myself. And when I was 14, I got my first electric violin. I borrowed one from a friend back then and I performed for the first time one of the Love of the Dance pieces with friends from middle school at our graduation ceremony, and that was great fun, actually. That's how it came to my life. Before that, I remember going to different friends trying to build some sort of a pickup for my acoustic violin, and a friend of mine just took a piece of an old speaker, like a small one, and he wired, and which I used to put it just underneath my strings behind my bridge, and that would just get the sound for my instruments, and I would just plug it into an amp just like that. And that's how I started just messing up with it. But the first ever electric violin that I touched was when I did that graduation ceremony. Yes, I own one. What? It's a great instrument. I saw it for the first time on YouTube when I was 17, I think, and I just decided I'm gonna have it someday. I saved that for like 2.5 years, and then I got it, and I couldn't believe. Right, I was like, really? Now that's it? Because I was so enjoying the path, the road, the waiting, and then it arrived, and I was like, oh wow, so that's it. Now I gotta play it. Yeah, sure. Yeah. To answer you, I hear myself twice, I think. I don't know where. No, I hear myself. I'll just pick. I know what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna turn my volume down when I speak. I don't hear my. I do have my. Just 1 second. Yeah, that's fine. Let me check that source. Yeah, that's a. It can be a headache sometimes. Can you hear me? I still hear myself double time. Don't worry, I'm gonna just mute myself when I play and when I speak, and that's it. So for the technique, can you hear me? Yes, amazing. So about the technique, technique and sound is all about research and study and practice, basically. So same as you learn the classical era, like Mozart, Handel, these kind of composers, you learn this particular style and sound. You can learn and practice and understand particular other genre sounds like jazz music, rock music, pop music. Irish bluegrass. Each one of those genres have their unique language and sound and techniques. So for rock music, I listened a lot to guitar players, electric guitar players, a lot. It would be Joe Satriani, John Petrucci, Steve Vai, Paul Gilbert, Andy Timmons, Yngwie Malmsteen. There's quite a few more that I just forgot, but there's quite a lot that I used to listen to, and I learned and to understand the language, basically, because that's where it's coming from, these people or that kind of music. So you need to listen to all of that and understand that, and I was trying to mimic the same sounds that I was hearing, basically, just on my instrument. And that's how I developed my own technique and my own take on the genre. And then there's other genres. And it works the same. Just need to listen to a lot of things and different things and just get to experiment with it and get to play it a lot until you have it. Obviously, you can also take lessons or speak to people. That's also a great idea and very recommended, obviously. But something that one of my professors back in college said that if you want to understand a certain type of music, a certain style, you go to the place where it's being developed or the place where it's happening the most, and you be there, and you learn from the people that do it all the time. That's how basically you do it. That's the best way. He said you cannot just study and study and read. Sometimes you need to experience it, like, in first person. And I totally agree with that. Now, to the other question, I play a fretless viper. Back in the day, I thought, I don't need frets on my instruments. I've been training a lot and enough to play in tune. And that would be forever my aim, to play in tune. I don't want to play out of tune. And I don't need frets to help me to play in tune. I felt like this is for, I don't know, pansies or like, you know, lazy people. But these days, let me tell you something else. There is something beyond that sound-wise. If you have frets, your sound is a bit different on sliding and so on. And I will probably get my next instrument, electric violin, my next electric violin, to be built with frets just for sound purposes. Just because I could hear a slight difference in the sound. And that's something that I'm personally interested about to explore, to see if I can come up with solutions for some of ideas that I've had in mind for some years now, and they don't really work quite well without frets. So we'll see. Okay, that's quite a big of an answer, but I'll try to cover it all and as fast as possible, not to go too much around. Basically, first of all, I was in my, I think, second year in college when I realized that I do want to do creative stuff with my music, not with my music, because back then I had very little of my music. But I decided officially, second year into college, that I want to create more and make it as part of my career. Now, when I came up with the concept of Crazy Violin Adventure, where basically, I'll explain. The concept is that I choose a place around the world, a country, and I look at pictures, at videos, I read about it, I make a little research, I check the local music, aesthetics and aspects, and I gather a whole picture out of it, and I write an original tune about this country, taking into consideration all the aesthetical and musical aspects of the country. And I travel to that place with my electric violin, I mount a GoPro on the violin, and I shoot a video clip while traveling in this place. And the outcome is a lovely video that where you see all the views, natural views of a place, and you see my hands playing and all the views behind it with music that is dedicated to this specific place. So the process for that, or the process for anything, could be either I have something in my mind, I just have a melody, it's in my mind and I want to do something with it. So I would do that. Like, I would sit down and work it out, develop something out of it. That's one possibility, scenario, let's call it. Another thing would be, because of this concept, sometimes I need to create dedicated music to a place I've never been or heard of, or I'm not particularly interested with the local music. So it's a research, and then I need to get inspired. So I would start with a small idea, and then slowly, bit by bit, I will develop more ideas while I work on the tune. It could be that I will start with just, I don't know, four notes, and I would start, I would just get around in the software, and the music software, and then I would think, okay, maybe I could add a piano here, maybe let's add something like a beat there, And then along the way, I would come up with more ideas and more ideas and more ideas. And then through the process, I get more inspired and then I get more ideas. That's another possibility. It's not that I have something fixed in my mind that I just go to, but I let the process lead me. It happened, for example, when I traveled in Madagascar. I was doing a crazy violin adventure project there. I started with very little bit of music when I arrived there. And it turned out to something very beautiful, in my opinion, because each day that was passing, I was writing more and recording more. So it became a very authentic kind of experience. I was getting inspired by the actual place, by being there and seeing everything and speaking to people. And each day I recorded more. So that's very authentic when you record it on the spot and wrote more music. So yeah, that's another way. It's your next. Sure. I sent you an excerpt that I sent to GoPro when they wanted to share this on their social medias after they given me the award. And that one was particularly written about England and Wales, and was shot in England and Wales. The video is on YouTube. You can just search it, Crazy Violin Adventure. You'll find it. Yes. This piece, first of all, started as a concept that I created for myself, to be honest. it is meant to inspire me and make me happy creating something for myself, basically. Because as a musician, I've been on tours a lot, and I was thinking to myself, the lifestyle of a touring musician is very hectic, and you just arrive in a new place, probably a place you've never been to. You go into rehearsal and you do a concert, and the next day you're gone. In a good case, it would be maybe 2 days or 3 days maximum, but you will never get to experience the place properly. You would never get to explore the place. And I grew up as a kid who really loved nature. I love nature. I love just walking and outdoors, forests, beach, everything. And I thought to myself, what can I do to keep doing music, but be creative and inspired and enjoy different kinds of music and enjoy traveling, but the kind of traveling that I like, nature. I love nature. And then it just struck me like that. I saw a GoPro mounted on a friend of mine guitar, and I thought, ah, that's cool. He can take videos of his gigs and stuff, and that's a cool angle. You see his fingers. I thought I should get one and maybe just film my gigs. And then it just struck me, okay, no, I need to do something else with it. And it's crazy because the opening frame with the violin in my video Crazy Violin Adventure is the exact image that I saw in my mind one day. It just struck me like that. And then I decided, okay, I'm going to do that. I'm going to create music about different places so I can go and visit them, enjoy the nature there, write music about it, perform it, record it, produce it, and hopefully get something out of it because it's visual as well. And that could get me going around in so many places. And that's how it started. And the first video got the GoPro Award. So I thought, okay, that's a good start, I guess. Yeah, send me the link. Yes. I'm ready. Wow, there's quite many. This is quite many. A Dolce Gabbana fashion show in Italy. Six. My pets. Napo, Bel, Kedar, and who's the last one? We're missing one, I think. No, I'm not. They died. Both. What motivates me? Creativity. I don't watch much of stuff on YouTube, to be honest. Favorite to cover. Ooh, that's hard. we play shitloads of covers, you know. I don't know what to say. No, seriously, I don't know what to say. Because I play so much music. Three people that I admire. My dad, my mom, and I'll name four, my two previous violin teacher. I grew up with both, so both. John Mayer, God, there's more. I totally forgot. John Mayer, Dirty Loops, and Nowhere. Sorry, I take my time. How long do we have? Amazing. Okay, so it might be like 5 to 10 minutes. First of all, look inside yourself and think for real what you really feel like doing with music. Because most people grow up playing an instrument and playing a certain kind of genre. And not necessarily wanting to continue with this specific genre, but they don't know what to do because you grow up in a certain way and you think like, oh, I'm breaking the rules, I'm doing something wrong, I'm a bad person, I'm a bad musician. That's not true. You, first of all, you do need to look deep inside yourself and think, what makes you fly? Literally, what makes you feel like you want to fly? And I've had that kind of feeling since I started playing with other genres of music. I grew up with classical music, obviously, and I'm trained, professionally trained in classical music, but I always liked other genres of music, and I always had the feeling inside myself that I'm going to do other genres of music as for my career, because I just enjoy music in general. And when I was 15, I found out that classical violinists on the big scale have very tough life. They are very much focused and zoned, and they have to remember a lot of texts, and they don't get to social much, if at all. I know it looks much different on social media, but social media is a big deceiving tool. But it's very strict and serious, and which can be great. Nothing against that, but it means that you have to be focused all the time. You always have to be zoning. And those are people who are more famous violinists. And I know that there is the freaking out kind of environment before a concert. It's there even for the greatest. They always have this kind of closing down moments where they just need to focus on the upcoming performance, and they cannot even speak to other people. You cannot speak to them, and that's part of this thing. And it's a lot of traveling, which can be fun, but as I said, when you move from venue to venue, it can be exhausting as well. But fair enough. That's things to consider. So when I was 15, I researched all those things, and I thought, I'm not sure I really want to have that kind of lifestyle, because I like classical music, but I like other kinds of music as well. So obviously I went to study in a proper university in London afterwards, and I did have the kind of question, should I go to a classical university in London, or should I go to Berklee College of Music in Boston, because I got into that as well. But I just chose the classical institution just to continue and develop my abilities. So then I can tell myself, okay, I've done this the right way, and it's time to move on and do some other stuff as well. So just to start with, look in deep inside and see what you feel about music in general, not just the instrument. Because I felt that violin to me wasn't just the horn of classical music, it's an instrument in general. And when you ask a person, for example, like if someone tells you, I play the piano, you don't necessarily think that, oh, they play classical music. They could play jazz, they could play pop, they could be a lot of things within that. But when someone is telling you, I play the violin, it immediately falls under classical music. And that's an interesting thing I got to realize. So I thought, okay, maybe that should be changed as a first thing. Now, a second thing, you want to understand the market of which field you are in. Because if you just study and you think like, oh, I'm going to finish uni and there's going to be a red carpet ready for me and I'm going to conquer the world, that's nice to think, but reality is not really like that. And a Cinderella story is one of million. So I wouldn't count on those things. I know everyone is talented, everyone is great. So many people getting so many great comments from their surroundings, but reality acts much differently. I've seen a lot of colleagues of mine, great players, finishing first degree, thinking, okay, and then nothing. No one is there with red carpet ready. And then they would think, okay, so what shall I do? What shall I do? Okay, let's do another degree. I can practice more. Maybe I will be better. And in my opinion, that's a kind of a mistake. You don't want to do that because you don't want to get stuck in studies all the, like, for many years. You want to start actually pushing for work out there in the real world, because no one prepares us for that, for real. I mean, there is no course to understand how does it work outside and how to be a musician, like a full-time working musician. And I'm not talking about teaching, I'm talking about performing. I perform full-time. That's what I live off. And thankfully now we have a catastrophe around the world, but I managed to have savings from performances. And I'm very proud of it because I've done it all from performances. And it feels great. So you want to understand the market of the field which you are in, because classical music is not a big market. And the problem is where we have not enough demand and too much to offer. So you need to people need to understand that if they are in the classical music field, and take it into consideration, and because then you cannot complain if you don't check the field and the market. So it's hard when there's not enough demand for players or great players, or and there's too many players that won't take to fill up positions. So people do need to understand that and take that into consideration. Then another thing, you can still be a classical musician but work as a musician in general, which means use your abilities, use your mastery of the instrument, and you can do gigs. You can do, I mean, just normal gigs, non-classical music gigs. You can still get paid, and that's a good thing, because people don't understand that they can still utilize their abilities and to get paid. And when you get paid, and it doesn't have to mean that you play every day, all day pop music or music that you don't like. It means that you get paid to do something that you are trained to do. Yes, even though you don't really like the music, I don't think. I think very few people don't like pop music, or, you know, like loving just classical music. It's good to get paid as a player in general. It gives you the time and space and the money to stay calm and work on your stuff that you're actually interested with. I've done it when I was a student. I was struggling for 2 or 3 years. I was struggling with paying my rent, being a student, practicing, buying food, all the very basic needs of life. And then I started doing some function gigs, and suddenly I had money. I could breathe, and I could focus on my studies, and I could focus on creating my original music and working on stuff that I was really interested with. And I had the stability, financial stability, and basically time, and freedom to put time on what I wanted to put. And that's an important thing. So if you have skills, utilize them for different genres if you can, because there is demand for outside of classical music, obviously there is, because the market is growing, the market circles are growing outside there. There's a lot of market circles. There's events markets, there's private events, there's corporate events, there's a lot, there's pub scenes. I'm not a big fan of that, but there's a lot that you can get involved with. There's literally a lot. There's lounge music venues, or demand for those kind of bands that do background music. There's a lot you can get paid for. So I wouldn't dismiss that. I would say use that, because a lot of people are struggling. I see a lot of my colleagues from the classical world struggling to pay rent, and I find it absolutely horrible. I just don't want to be a struggling musician or a surviving musician. I want to be a winning musician. I want to be stable, and I want to enjoy creating what I want to enjoy. Now, we have social media these days, and that can be a great thing, and it can be the worst thing ever. It requires people to understand how it works and how exactly things are going on. There are different platforms, and each of these platforms work differently to the other. So, for example, this Facebook has a certain kind of crowd to it. It's older people mostly. It would be more from 27 and on, even 30 and on, that they're going to be your main crowd on Facebook. So and there are ways to promote yourself there. I personally wouldn't use any of the Facebook/Instagram ads. I think they're not working the way they're meant to work. It's a money machine for those companies. There are other ways to do targeting. I'm not going to go into targeting now, because it's a massive topic, and it's a very technological topic. Yeah. But content making, you need to tailor your content to each platform. YouTube works in a certain way. Instagram works in a different way. Facebook works in a totally different way. Check timings, when to post. When is the prime time to post? What hour of the day and what day of the week? Sometimes you don't need to post every day. Sometimes you need to post every day. Sometimes you might need to post twice a day. That's a bit of like out of the set of skills that we have as musicians, but that's part of the do-it-yourself musician set of skills. And unfortunately, these days, it becomes a must. Unless you have a hired team around you somehow to do that for you, then people would have to do this themselves. And I started doing this myself when I was in college. And it's hard at first. It explodes your mind. You think like, I don't want to be slave to that crap, but it's part of the business these days. It can be deceiving as well. There's a lot of people that tell you that they are ABCD of great players on Instagram or Facebook or even YouTube, and you don't know sometimes what's behind it. It's very important to understand that these can be very deceiving tools. You might think that, wow, this person is so successful. How? What's wrong about me? Nothing is wrong about you. Because a lot of people, not a lot, but some people, I've seen some people that would create an image of a superstar on Instagram. Let's take it for instance. And because it's a very visual kind of platform, and people just click like for the visuals. In many cases, they don't care much about what's in the video or what's behind the picture or how this person really plays like. So it's very easy to fall into depression, seeing a lot of successful people there. But if you really check, run a proper research, and then you find out, ah, that's a student, that's someone who's still a teenager, this person lives with their parents, this person, I don't know, they don't get really paid to perform much. And then you realize, okay, so it's not so, it doesn't really work like that. There's still something, I want to call them the old rules, but there's still these kind of old rules that are the ultimate requirements, and they will be always like that. To do something on a great level, you need to play well. I don't believe that someone can be a shitty player and somehow get world success. It doesn't work like that. You need to be a good player, a good musician. You don't have to be a great person, but personality helps, especially if you have charisma. Stage presence is very important these days. It's very important. Stage presence and visuality, these things are big sellers these days. It's important. Content making, when you create content, it needs to be very appealing to the eyes. It's not an easy task, but if you use great thumbnails that make people wonder, ah, what's that? I want to click on that. There you go. That works on social media. Beyond being a good player, yes, because not always it counts, as we can see these days in social media, there is something else. If you really want to make a change and create something for yourself, concepts are the ways to get you forward. Because if you are just reproducing the same stuff like everyone else, it's not likely that you will get big stuff. You might get gigs, and in your area, especially, fine. If people are into that, you can get work, definitely. But if someone wants to have it like big time, concepts are the way. If you have a creative, unique concept that no one did before, and it's something that people get inspired by, and it's something that people can, I don't know, gather because of, and then you're doing something that might get you pushed really forward. Because if you have something that is a unique and different and creative and of high quality as well, and on the top of that, you know how to look very entertaining when you perform, because that's very important these days, you are in a great position, because that's what labels are looking for. I know they have less power these days, but they are still holding the business. There's many people that play amazing. Many. I see some of them, and I see them just playing few recitals a year and teaching and fading away. Because there's a lot of great players there, a lot, but not all of them look interesting on stage or have something new to say. We've heard millions and millions of versions of Mendelssohn Violin Concerto. So another version is like, fine. Take into consideration that most people these days listen to those pieces because of the music, because they like the music. So if you think of it, maybe create new music for violin. That might get people interested with that. I think we're in at an interesting time in this life, where violin has the opportunity to become an instrument of not just performers, but of people that create new music for the instruments and in different genres. Because I really don't believe it's just an instrument of one genre. It's a universal instrument, and you can do a lot with it. You just need to be a bit smart and try not to reproduce a lot. You need to be interactive when you perform, especially when you perform. Performing is so important. There's a lot of people that record and have great videos on YouTube, and they would have mass followings, but you won't see them live on stage because they probably don't have that excitement within them when they perform. And labels are looking into those things, and it's not a new thing. It's been that kind of thing's been here forever. So yes, I personally, you can make an income and a decent income and a living out of being a social media influencer as a musician or a YouTuber. You can do that. It's possible, definitely. For me, in my own opinion, I don't want to be a screen musician. I want to be a live musician. I like to perform live on stage. What can I say? So yeah, it's important to find out your way, your own direction, your own passion, to be very entertaining when you perform, still keep good quality of things. I know there's a lot of people that don't care and don't understand, but at the end of the day, if you check out people that made it really big or people that became legends, they are the finest players or the finest singers, and that's how you have it, or the finest rappers. You don't have like middle section, like middle level people hitting it really big, unless they came up with such a concept that made people thinking, wow, I've never had anything like that. Yeah. And yeah, that's it, basically. Go be creative, guys. We have so much to offer. So, yeah. Thank you. I have an exciting one coming up very soon. I have two exciting videos coming up. One of them it belongs to the cover field, let's call it, but it has been done in a way that we haven't seen much yet, I would say. And the other one is another one of my Crazy Violin Adventure original videos. This is going to be just, I promise you, a fairy tale. Is that the other way around? Sure. Yeah, but it's the other way around. By the way, I just gave everyone here a very easy marketing tool. Like, I just did that. That's marketing. Thank you. Bye, thank you.